Okay, my name is Doug Fairbairn. I'm sitting here with Jeff Katz as my fellow interviewer. Our interviewee is Michael Slater, who has joined us to talk about his history in the microprocessor-related business and other things that he's been involved in. And so welcome, Michael. Glad to have you here.
Thank you.
So the first thing we'd like to do is just let you introduce yourself and talk about your life from the very early days. You know, where were you? Where were you born? Where did you grow up?
Sure.
Tell us a little bit about your upbringing, especially in terms of family life, parents, or whatever that might have influenced you or not, and then we'll progress from there. So why don't we just start with that, Michael?
Okay, great. Yeah, I was born in Los Angeles, 1955.
The real Los Angeles? I mean, just...
Yeah, sort of in the middle of, I guess it's West Hollywood, mm-hmm. Actually an area that was a pretty dense Jewish ghetto at the time, between Fairfax, next to Fairfax, between Beverly and Melrose, and...
I know that neighborhood.
Yeah, I remember one of the more shocking things of my childhood was noticing the women working at the bakery had numbers on their arms and asking how come they had numbers tattooed on their arms. It was a very safe place. You know, I mean, I think from the time I was 7 or 8, I was walking 10, 20 blocks to go get a taco or something or go to the drugstore. Mm-hmm. You know, not what I think parents, what their kids do in Los Angeles today. But I enjoyed growing up there. My father was a school psychologist, and my mother was an artist. And they also ran a summer camp called Camp Roosevelt down near Idlewild, California. Mm-hmm. And so every summer I was there. So I'd be in the summers up in the mountains, then back into LA for the rest of the year. And I was always a really curious kid. I'm still a really curious person. And, you know, the first thing I remember, and my guess is I was like 6 or 7, about my interest in electronics and electricity, is that we had this dining table, and next to the dining table there was a little shelf that had a toaster on it. And then the power cord for the toaster was like stapled into the wall and then plugged into the thing, and I was looking at it and saying, why does it have two wires? All it's doing is delivering electricity to the toaster where the toaster turns it into heat. And, you know, my family was completely flummoxed. Nobody was prepared to answer that question. But that's sort of my earliest deep electrical curiosity question that I remember. And then another thing I remember from, again, I'm terrible at sort of figuring out, was I 5 or 10 or 12, but somewhere in there, our TV broke. Mm-hmm. And we took it to this... maybe 6 blocks away, and there was a guy who had converted his garage behind his house into this TV repair shop. And I thought, wow, this is what I want to do. You know, this is it, you know. And I remember being really shocked when I left, when as we were leaving, my father said, no, this is not what you're going to do. You're going to go to college. You're going to get a degree. You're going to work for a big company. You know, this is...
Be a doctor or a lawyer or something?
No, engineering. But you're not going to be the guy in the garage, you know. Okay. You're not going to be the guy fixing TVs, you know. So I don't think I quite knew how to make sense of all that at the time. But, you know, and certainly from the time I was an early teenager, I was reading popular electronics and popular science and building some of those kits. I remember building a theremin, which I never got to work. I built a Heathkit oscilloscope, which I did get to mm-hmm. work. And I built a Heathkit vacuum tube shortwave receiver. And my most vivid memory of that was having finished the whole thing and then found out that I was numbering the pins on the tube sockets in the wrong direction. Oh. So I had to go remove every wire and completely rewire it, but it did ultimately work.
Had you burned out the tubes?
No. Oh. No, it worked. The tubes were not in the sockets yet.
So what year were you born? Just sort of
1955.
Okay.
You know, another memory from my childhood, and I don't know too much about what this thing was, but down the street towards the drugstore that I used to walk down to, there was this glass building that had these classical TV mainframe computers in it. You know, it had the two reels that would jerk back and forth, you know, and it was mm-hmm. like this, it was this mysterious shrine. You know, I had no idea what it was, but clearly these were computers, you know, and it was this like, this other attractive and mysterious thing. And then my father really tried to do everything he could to support my hobby, even though he couldn't understand it very well. Mm-hmm. He even went and took a class to try to learn a bit of electronics. And I remember him coming home one day and telling me that thyristors were the future. I don't even remember what they are. And then I would go through the popular electronics magazines, and I would come up with this parts list, you know. And then he'd take me to the local electronics store where the guys would sort of roll their eyes, you know. And I think I way stretched his financial abilities, but he did not want to say no when I wanted to build something. And so I built a lot of stuff, and some of it worked. And then the other thing he found for me is because he worked for the school district, there was some sort of a surplus electronics distribution system. And it was only available to employees of the school districts. And it was all this equipment, I think, mostly coming out of the military or government research and stuff. And everything was 5 cents a pound. So I got all kinds of equipment, you know.
But it wasn't the newest technology.
No, nor did most of it even work. And in fact, most of what I did through my, like, 13, 14, maybe a little younger than that, because once girls came into play, I probably did less of it. But I basically would just take them apart, and I just had boxes, and I would just decompose them into their pieces. I still have at home some of those, like, 50-year-old capacitors and stuff. So that was sort of my pre-college environment. You know, I did grow up during the Vietnam War, and so, you know, I had long hair, was certainly part, identified with the whole counterculture movement and all that. I went to a private high school out in North Hollywood where everybody was anti-war. Looking back on it now, I realize I had no idea why I was anti-war. In fact, I didn't really understand the war at all, but it was clear what the right thing was to choose. And, you know, and going to demonstrations in San Francisco, and, you know, so that was a big part of that scene. So I had some feeling of sort of being part of a counterculture, and I went to Berkeley, and I think I was, my hope was that there was this sort of merging coming up of the, you know, the counterculture world and the business world and the technology world, and, you know, that I was going to somehow be part of all that. Mm-hmm. Sort of happened.
So what drove you to Berkeley? Was it the counterculture aspect of the school? Was it the electronics?
What drove me to Berkeley was that Stanford rejected me, and so did MIT. So those were the three schools that I applied to, and Berkeley's where I got it.
And were there any, you said your father did his best to support you. Were there other teachers or whatever in high school or whatever that supported your activities or helped you along, or was it you were pretty much on your own?
Not directly in electronics. There was a guy there named Mr. Zimmerman who did teach the sort of more advanced math classes. Mm-hmm. And so he really, you know, encouraged relatively advanced thinking. You know, we were doing, you know, like second year college level calculus by the time I graduated high school. So he's just a real free thinking guy who would really support everybody's interests. Then there was a guy named Saul Rubinstein who was the science teacher. He was just a charismatic guy, and I think he did a good job instilling in me a respect for science and an interest in science. My clearest memory of high school science is breeding Drosophila and doing genetics experiments. That was pretty cool. I don't think there really was any electronics to speak of, or even electricity, really, in that.
So what year did you graduate high school?
73. Okay. So I went to Berkeley from 73 to 77.
And what was it like entering Berkeley? Did you feel like this was a perfect place for you to be? What was your...
Yeah, I really liked Berkeley. The first year or so I found very easy. Physics, at least lower level physics, came very naturally to me. I think I was one of the only people out of the class of 500 to get a perfect score on the first semester physics class, which excited me. The basics, you know, physics just always made total sense to me. I also took a lot of math classes, and I had a harder time with the more advanced math classes. Actually, the first year was okay, and then the second year, I started getting sort of tired of the conceptual abstraction of all the math. Another shift, this was just as digital was really coming on, right? So I had gone to college thinking I was going to learn how to build radios and TVs, right? And I had only this tiny little understanding at all of computers. Mm-hmm. But once I started getting into classes that were digital, might not have been until my second year, I said, you know, this makes way more sense to me. It's logic instead of math, and it just feels right and is intuitive. And you know, and there were a couple of professors who were important to me. Al Despain, who ran the SETI project, I think, for years after that, was a computer architect and who really encouraged me in that sort of hardware-oriented path. He did, you know, about halfway through, as I started writing some software, I think we were using teletypes with paper tape hooked up to a PDP 11 at Lawrence, what is it, not the lab that's right up there on the hill above Berkeley.
Yeah. Lawrence Radiation Labs? Or
I don't think it's the Radiation Labs. There's like a museum or something up there in the hills. Yeah, and they,
Livermore, maybe.
No, it's much closer. It's just right up in the Berkeley Hills. Yeah. But they had a bunch of time-shared.
Oh, the Hall of Science, they call it.
Yeah, it's probably what it is. It's the Hall of Science, yeah. So I remember writing a program that could play Crazy Eights. And I wrote a program that would generate magic squares of any size, where you know, all the dimensions added up to the same thing. And I think it was all basic. It was all in basic, you know, and then you punch out your paper tape and put a little rubber band around it and carry your paper tape home so that the next time you could load the paper tape in and then you could edit your program.
On what computer was that
running? It was a PDP 11, I think. And then in the main university, I think that was a DEC System 10, you know, which you couldn't even see, right? You had those old IBM punch card machines and you had to sit there and punch out your whole DEC. And then you submitted it, and then you waited an hour to get your big printout back and find out you had a typo, right? And then you go find that card, and, you know, I mean, so that was like an unbelievably tedious way to program. But once I got onto the teletypes at, with the PDP-11, it's like, okay, now this has gotten fun. And for better or worse, I was ready at that point to switch to a programming career, and it was Al Despain who convinced me that hardware was the real stuff, and and I should stick to hardware. I'm not actually sure that was good advice, but I ended up doing a fair amount of both.
So, were you becoming aware of the microprocessor was just appearing on the market at that time, right?
Yeah, absolutely.
And how did that come into your view in the college career, or is that later?
Yes. I think it wasn't until my junior year we had a lab where I believe we were using 4040s and then maybe 8008s. This would have been 76, 77. So I got to write some machine code for those things and build little things. So I was exposed to them at that time. And then I remember reading, like, there was Processor Technology Company, and you know, there were all these very, very early personal computer companies selling, like, memory boards and stuff. You know, George Morrow was still around then selling stuff. And I remember that I had a really hard time making any sense out of all of it, right? There's all these things, right? But it didn't really aggregate to anything that I could figure out that I could do anything with. So the hardware side of computing, I didn't do, you know, I never really got into doing architecture design. I was always focused on applications. And that was actually, I'd say, the one frustration I had with Berkeley is that I wanted to build stuff and they wanted to talk theory. You know, I mean, like, there was no class at Berkeley that would explain to you how a television worked, right? They said, if you want to know that, go to Votech School,
right?
So, you know, I felt a little starved by Berkeley in that, you know, they really wanted to send people down a deep theoretical path. And I was always really practically oriented. I mean, what's always thrilled me more than anything else is building things. And you know, and I think what kept me out of being interested in, like, the semiconductor physics and all that is it's like, I'm never going to be able to build anything with this, right? Maybe I could become part of some multi-billion dollar corporation that's building something with this, but it's completely beyond what an individual can do. So for whatever reason, and I think part of it goes back to that guy in the garage fixing TVs, and part of it goes back to my mother, who was always an independent artist working out of a studio behind our house.
She a painter? Or, I mean,
she's a ceramic artist. She was a ceramic artist. I always That was always sort of my model, right? The big company thing never quite made sense to me, and I just wanted to be making stuff and relatively independent.
So speaking of that, was your counterculture ideas, were it fueled at Berkeley? Did you get involved in any of the
I didn't get
activities,
too
or you were
I wasn't really very political, no. You know, there was certainly the those of us who were the long hairs tended to hang out together, but I think it was really much more social than political, and by then the protests were fading away, and
so you got a BSEE,
yeah,
in what, 77,
yep,
and the focus there, you had done microprocessor work, but what? I mean, sort of what direction were you thinking you were going at that point?
So at that point, I was pretty much focused on embedded microprocessor applications.
Okay.
I felt like general purpose computers were uninteresting because who needs a computer, right? Until they became communication devices, they actually were sort of uninteresting.
Right.
But I loved making things, building something where in the end, you know, it moves or does
stuff.
Something
yeah.
or, you know. So I was focused on embedded stuff or sort of instrumentation kind of applications. Actually, for my last year, where I wanted to be able to do something practical, I did an independent study project through Alde Spain.
Mm-hmm.
And I built, I think this was 8080 based, with about five cards, I built a computer system. You know, I had a card full of 2102 1K memory chips and 1702, I think they were, those EEPROMs, and there was a little monitor program in there, and I actually built a logic analyzer. It was pretty, it was somewhat primitive, but it basically had a bunch of probes, and at each clock it would capture the state of all the probes, and then it had an MSI-based CRT display driver that would draw little ups and downs, you know, based on that. I had a terrible time getting it to work. It was really flaky. And then I had to go in and show it to Professor Despain, and it all worked. And that's the only time it ever worked.
So you came out with a BSEE, and what was the next step?
So I had a summer job at Ampex in Redwood City, that you know gave me a little glimpse into sort of what the industrial world was like. It was a pretty interesting place at the time. They were actually working on a government contract where they were building an optical computer that they could fly around in an airplane that would capture the full broadband radio spectrum and find the stations and decipher them. And I guess they do that today, but now they can do that with electronics. But at the time, it was some like optical Fourier analyzer or something, you know. It made no sense to me at all. But the other thing we built there was a frame store.
Mm.
And it would store one TV frame,
mm-hmm.
and it was a box like that, you know, with like 15 boards covered with memory chips. And that was part of something feeding some of their video recording business. But, you know, I found it only mildly interesting there. And Hewlett Packard, for whatever reason, had just always been my iconic company. I believe it was actually the only place I applied for a job after I graduated.
Mm-hmm.
And I was completely ignorant of sort of economics and politics at that point. But I guess 1977 was not a good year. I was the only person they hired out of Berkeley that year. So I was very lucky. And I spent 3 years at HP down in Santa Clara. And I think because I had some writing skills, and I guess it was just the project that was there waiting. What I did for them first was they had had a problem, and now as they had started putting microprocessors into all their instruments, the people that used to fix the instruments no longer understood how they worked. Right, when you had a voltmeter, right, and it was all analog, you know, that was one thing. Now that I've got this digital thing, the technicians had a hard time fixing them. And HP, of course, made a whole bunch of tools, right? So they had this thing called signature analysis that they invented, and then they had logic probes and pulsers and current tracers, right? So I wrote a self-instructional text. We designed a briefcase computer that had places where you could hook in all those things and where you could induce faults. And then I wrote the self-instructional text that walked people through how to induce a fault, use the troubleshooting tools to track it down, fix it.
So the Santa Clara division was the instrument division, right?
Right.
They were doing...
The part I was in was these test equipment things. Actually, right down the hall was the GPS group, Charlie Trimble, where, you know, probably one of HP's poorer decisions. you know, they had built a fully operating GPS unit, and I think they had put a couple million dollars into it. And they decided to discontinue it, and Charlie Trimble bought the whole thing from them for like a couple $100,000, I think, all the rights to everything they had developed, and Trimble ended up being a significant company in the in the GPS business. At the time, there was a semiconductor fab there, and then the computer people were down the street up at Wolf Road, right? So we were definitely the instrument. It was all one company then, but we were definitely the instrument people. So that was most of what I worked on through my 3 years at HP. And while there were a lot of great things about HP, it's just, I just had trouble feeling like an ant in a maze. You know, I just felt like nothing I could do was ever really going to have any meaningful impact. And I didn't really understand management or any of that. I had always liked to teach, and I had somehow gotten connected with the University of Santa Clara doing continuing education courses there. And then I'd seen an ad from McGraw-Hill at the time was running seminars around the world where they would get technical experts. And I responded to one of their ads and ended up teaching seminars for them, you know, on microprocessor interfacing was really the main thing I was focused on then, was how to connect it to the real world. And then it was actually...
The teaching path was just sort of came out of your own self-interest. Wasn't really...
Yeah, and looking for work. Looking for things to do and enjoying it.
So during those 3 years at HP, was there any outside groups or activities that kind of caught your interest? Or, you know, you were mainly sort of buried in the...
No, I regret that I never fully engaged in it, but I was in there for a few of those homebrew computer club meetings. And I remember People's Computer Company, Dennis Allison's thing down in Menlo Park. You know, so I was sort of around the fringes of all that, but it's like it somehow didn't quite gel with me. You know.
Did you have any vision of what the microprocessor was to come? You know, was it just a tool of the day? Did you?
So I certainly viewed it as the most important tool of the day and probably of a long time to come, because it had just become this universal building block for building whatever you wanted to build. But I was still really thinking embedded devices at that point. I had no vision of the web or the internet or any of that, for sure. I think until I became an analyst, I didn't really absorb the meaning of logarithmic or exponential growth, you know, and how, you know, if you sort of looked at things incremental on a linear curve, you wouldn't have expected microprocessors or memory chips to go very far, you know. And it's really when you get the fact that, you know, this is doubling every period, not increasing by the same amount every period, that you start having to really shift how you think about it to envisioning entirely new kinds of things.
Yeah, I think everybody struggles with grasping exponentials. We always look at sort of a few years or whatever, and during that period, or periods of time, and during that period. But when the exponentials take over, you really got to be cognizant of that. Okay, so you started teaching. You were working with McGraw-Hill.
And then I think it was Ford Aerospace hired me to do a bunch of classes for them. And about at this point, I was just way too busy, and I said, you know, either I need to stop my freelancing or I need to quit my job, and I quit my job. I just really self-identified with being sort of a freelancer. It was oddly early in my career to do that. I was 3 years out of college, but I had these teaching jobs that I figured would sustain me at some level, and then started looking for we called it consulting back then. I think freelance engineering is probably a better name for it. Mm-hmm. One of my first clients was a guy named Horace Ania, who ran a company called Heuristics that made the very first speech recognition board for PCs. Didn't work worth a damn, but you know, if you spoke really well on a few words, it would work.
Right.
So I did some work for him, you know, and you know, I had a decent freelance engineering business, small. Then I ended up.
So were you still teaching as well? You were doing some engineering work and teaching?
Yeah, particularly for McGraw-Hill.
Mm-hmm.
I was basically designing embedded microprocessor things. At that point, it was mostly Z80.
Mm-hmm.
And in general, I did end up writing all the software as well. So, you know, I became a pretty adept Z80 assembly language programmer. wrote lots and lots of code.
So you went freelance in about 1980?
Yes. And then after just about a year of that, I was getting some work subcontracted by a company called Logical Services.
Mm-hmm.
It was down in Santa Clara, run by Bob Orlickson and John Nichols. And so they hired me to be their sort of manager. So mm-hmm. I worked there for a few years, still doing consulting, but under their purview. But again, just ultimately I wanted to be on my own. So.
Mm-hmm.
I left there after 3 years, continued to do that sort of consulting work for another several years. Air Test Systems, AEHR, was one of my major clients. They build these IC burn-in ovens.
Mm-hmm.
And I built a control system for them, built some stepper motor-based control systems for some sort of medical thing that had to go squirt a little drop of something into each of these little buckets. That was the sort of stuff I loved doing, where it's like you make something move and it does something. I did a hardware and software for a 35-millimeter recorder back when, like, when you made your slide presentation,
mm-hmm.
right? And you then needed to image those onto 35-millimeter slides and then take the film to get developed so you could put the slides in the projector to show your thing. That's this thing with a little very high-resolution CRT and electronics that drove it to image the slide. So that was the sort of work that I was doing. And I did that, you know, through the 80s. And, you know, I was having a pretty good time. I was making decent money. I was working with a few colleagues, although I was still, you know, pretty much a one-man shop with the occasional co-worker. But you know, I'd always wanted to build a company, build a product, do something, mm-hmm. you know. And so I started looking around at a bunch of things. I actually looked at, like, piano tuning devices and guitar tuners. And, you know, I was fairly naive, I think, at that point about what it meant to really build a company. But, you know, I liked this idea of hardware devices.
So were you musically oriented? Did
no.
you play an instrument or anything?
No. It was just an opportunity.
Mm-hmm.
The thing was, none of those things, I couldn't get over the hump of feeling like I could really do this.
Mm-hmm.
And so the other thing I'd done during those years is I wrote a textbook.
Hmm.
Because I'd always liked writing, and once I was out of HP and that was done, I said, well, I've sort of learned a way to approach building microprocessor-based systems and analyzing the timing and making mm-hmm. them reliable. And, you know, I mean, most of the things I've done in my life, I've done not because there's any rational explanation from them, but because something bubbles up and tells me to do it, and I can't right. stop. And the book was one of those things. But as soon as I finished the book, it was like, okay, well, like in a year, this is all going to be, you know, marginally obsolete. So maybe I could do a newsletter that would be a series of ongoing updates to the book.
Mm-hmm.
So that was the beginning of an idea to have a newsletter.
So did you get the book published by a major publisher? Or
yeah, the book was first published by a little publisher in Mountain View right here. I'm trying to remember what it's called. But I think they disappeared and sold it to Prentice Hall. So
mm-hmm.
it was published by Prentice Hall. It did reasonably well for many years, called Microprocessor-Based Design. So once I started looking into the idea of a newsletter, and I actually remember going down to the Palo Alto Library, you know, and picking books off the shelf, and sure enough, there was a newsletter association, and there was a book from the newsletter association on starting a newsletter. And then I started looking around for other computer industry newsletters, and I found Stuart Alsup and Esther Dyson. So I started looking at their businesses, and I thought, they seem to be having a pretty good time. And, you know, so they're running a conference, they're doing this newsletter. But, you know, these are like $3,000 events, industry executives, super lavish, right? So there's no way the technical people are going to do that. Yeah. But then you go to the IEEE conferences, you know, and you got rubber chicken at lunch and, you know, stale popcorn at the break and uncomfortable chairs through the whole thing. And, you know, and it's $250, right? Mm-hmm. And super technical with no, very little caring about the marketplace, yeah. Right? So these are some of the ideas that were going around in my head was that, you know, while their newsletter and conference model was really different in some way than what my market would take, there was something that I felt like was sort of halfway to what they were doing that would be appreciated by the microprocessor industry. So that led really first to doing the newsletter. The conference came later, mm-hmm. Just about a year later.
When was that roughly when the spark came to do the newsletter?
It was probably early 87 or late 86 because the first issue was September of 87. And it really had no strategic plan. There was no business plan really to speak of. I didn't even really understand who was going to be reading it. It was really all about writing about what I was interested in. And it was fortuitous that that happened to match what some community of people wanted to read.
By that time, did you consider yourself an analyst or a book author or an engineer or a what?
I really considered myself an engineer who could write.
Okay.
And it was really the feedback I got from the first few issues of Microprocessor Report that this was really something special that I think kept me down that path. I didn't really go into it believing that I could do anything special or having any special plan. Now, when I look back on it, I can see that we sort of, because of all of the landscape changes that were going on, we filled a couple of niches. As I've been meeting lately with some of the people I used to know years ago, a number of them have pointed out to me that while there was all this microprocessor activity going on in the late 80s and early 90s, it didn't function as a community until my conference. The conference was the thing that sort of brought the community together. I had no idea that's what I was doing. But and then in the newsletter, I mean, we would write these long, you know, we'd go to see Intel about this new microprocessor, right? And everybody else writes the sort of one-page summary about who they're going to sell it to. And we'd write six pages about the microarchitecture and the pipeline design. We were like the only people who were even asking Intel any of those kinds of questions. So we had information that nobody else really had. And again, it was no careful plan, just what seemed like an interesting thing to do. And then all of the risk stuff happened, right? So Spark came out and MIPS and all of these things. And each of them would come visit me and give me their spiel, and I'd write the article. And the genesis of the microprocessor forum was sitting there talking to some of these guys. I mean, I think the two archetypes for me were Dave Ditzel and John Mashey from the Spark and MIPS camps, and saying, okay, these guys can't both be right, right? They're telling mutually contradictory stories, but I don't have enough depth to make a judgment here, so let me put them both on stage. So that was really where the microprocessor forum came from, is that there were so many of these risk architectures coming out, and so many claims being made, and so many perspectives being presented, that it was really hard to sort it all out. So I thought, okay, well, let's get everybody together. And it was amazingly successful.
Okay, so let's back up a bit. You're an engineer doing individual consulting, and you started writing, and you wanted to write microprocessor report. You can do that. You can write it on your own, but now you need some place, somebody to send it to.
Right.
And you also, you know, it was, you were talking about we, you know, there are other contributors. So
right.
there's a step here in terms of the community that was, even if it was a small community, that was already formed or whatever.
Right.
So tell me about that. I mean, how many copies did you print, and
yep.
who did you send it to,
okay.
and how did that actually happen?
Okay, so that's a great reminder. So let me go back a few years to something called the Asilomar Microcomputer Workshop, which is still going on today.
Mm-hmm.
It's been around for, it must be 30-something years now. maybe 40. And it's always been sort of a slightly off-the-record IEEE event. It's not, it's sort of an official, I'm not sure where it is today, but it was sort of an official event, except they don't like to follow any of the rules. So it's, you know, it's always been by invitation only. Mm-hmm. And so it's sort of a social club. there were just a lot of great people that went there, you know, Stan Mazur and John Wharton. John ran it for a long time. Marianne Mueller, I think, runs it now. There were just a lot of really great people. Nick Tredenick, John Wakerly, Fred Terman, Jr. Mm-hmm. I started actually, I think it was my first year at HP, somebody else in the group had an invitation to go to that conference and gave it to me. And I went to the conference and sort of liked all those people, and then I think it was the following year they were looking for volunteers to help organize the conference, so I joined their planning committee. And the way the planning committee worked was basically to get together for dinner once a month and talk about what to do. And so I basically got to know a pretty exceptional group of people, really just by being at that SLMR microcomputer workshop year after year. And even though I only saw most of those people 3 days a year, after 5 years of 3 days a year, they start to feel like your friends.
Mm-hmm. How many people would typically attend those?
It's right around 100.
About 100. So there was a cadre in the middle of less than a dozen, probably, that were making that happen.
Right. And I think they're still there for the most part. it's definitely gone from being a group of 20-somethings to a group of gray hairs.
The same people? There's no new blood?
I actually haven't gone in about 5 years. I'm sure there's some new blood, but there's an awful lot of names I recognize that still go. So that sort of gave me both a set of really knowledgeable, experienced people from the microprocessor industry who mm-hmm. knew me and I got along well with, and it gave me a model of, through a series of $700 dinner meetings to be able to, you know, incent a group of people to help you do what you wanted to do. Mm-hmm. So that was really the key resource I had in terms of a group of people. None of them were ever paid. Mm-hmm. They just enjoyed doing it.
You mean writing for?
Writing for it or participating in the meetings. Or we had a very meticulous, painful review cycle. Mm-hmm. I did not come from journalism. And so from my point of view, everything had to be right. Mm-hmm. And these were highly technical articles, right? Mm-hmm. And both highly technical and sometimes fairly strong technically based opinions. Mm-hmm.
So they were peer reviewed by that cadre?
So we faxed every issue to about 10 people. We collected all those comments and we incorporated many, many changes. So it was an extremely painful review cycle. And something that was, again, almost unknown in the tech journalism industry is we sent the people we were writing about the drafts too. Mm-hmm. We usually ignored their comments on our opinions, but we wanted to at least correct our facts. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. So how often, in the beginning, you wrote the first one, how often did you plan to publish it? How often did you publish it?
I think we started as a monthly. And then after some amount of time, a year or two, we decided to go to every 2 weeks. Mm-hmm. And then after about a year of that, we just couldn't sustain it with our editorial cycle.
I was about to say, doing a peer review thing every month was difficult.
With our editorial cycle. So for most of the newsletter's history, it was actually on a three-week cycle. It may be the only publication in the world that ever published for an extended period of time on a three-week cycle. But it just turned out to be what we could do.
Right.
2 weeks was more than we could do, and a month felt too slow.
So again, you say we. You were making some money at this. This is your livelihood?
Sort of, yeah. My wife Irene was working with me at that point, and we were making our living off of this. It wasn't a fantastic living at that point. We had borrowed some money, and you know, you asked about finding subscribers, right? That's, of course, the big challenge with any business, right? It's getting customers.
Especially people to pay.
Yeah, so the Newsletter Association, through their books, they sort of taught a method, very traditional direct mail. You know, you've got your lift note, and you've got your, you know, the little handwritten thing on the outside of the envelope, you know, and the six pieces inside, and, you know, and then they had people who professionally wrote that crap, you know, and then there were all the EE Times and IEEE Computer and all those magazines whose lists you could rent. And so, you know, I think we sent about a million pieces of mail over the first 5 years of the newsletter, and that's what built the circulation of the newsletter.
What was the circulation growth pattern? The first year, were you selling dozens or hundreds or thousands?
I think we got to 100 and something the first year, and I think we probably got to 1,000 after maybe 5 years. And I don't think it ever got
and
much
the price
beyond
was
a few thousand. You know, I think it might have been, in the beginning, it might have been like 97, 297, and then the Newsletter Association liked sevens. And I think it got up to 495 or 595, something like that. So one of the things that, you know, I was completely ignorant about when I started this was that the semiconductor manufacturers were going to be the heart of the economics of this business. That they were the ones who were going to
pay. They were the source and the ones who wanted to read
it. They were the ones who were going to pay. They were the ones who were going to pay for this information. And that their level of price sensitivity was almost zero. Right? So that's why we, you know, what we learned very quickly in the first few years is that we couldn't get as many subscribers as we wanted, but the ones who would subscribe would pay a lot more than we thought they would pay. That my archetype of the subscriber was somebody like me, who is the freelance microprocessor user. But that, in fact, those people wouldn't pay. They read somebody else's copy.
I was a subscriber, and I would send my copy around to my staff of a dozen people. And I think they probably sent it places, too.
I'm sure there's a lot of circulation. And that is the, you know, the Achilles heel of the high-priced newsletter business. And I don't really know how that business has fared. I think the web has radically changed it, for sure. And but I don't think there's anybody writing the kind of articles we were writing back then.
Well, there are many self-proclaimed analysts
But they're,
that blog everything.
But they don't go as technically deep.
That's true.
I mean, and that was sort of the aberration of what I did, was that I considered myself completely ignorant of marketing and business at the time. I was only interested in the technology. And so this idea of what it would mean to be an analyst, I didn't even quite get, right? And I started talking to all these financial analysts because, you know, when Intel announces a bug in the floating point multiplier, whatever that was, you know, it's like, I had become the guy who, one, would spend hours on the phone talking to them, who, two, understood the truth of what it was and could put it into terms that they could understand. So I spent hours a day with reporters, typically, and I think that drove a lot of our circulation, too. I was by far the most widely quoted person in the microprocessor industry. And so that was another whole element of the business, was sort of serving the rest of the journalistic press. And but when they say analyst, they really are talking usually about like a data quest sort of analyst who typically is technically shallow but has all kinds of market numbers, right? And I didn't have any market numbers. I didn't know who's selling how many of what or how to get any of that. I wanted those numbers, but to me that was completely alien. I had no idea how to do that. And then there were all of the financial analysts that were really oriented around the economic health of these companies, which, again, I started out completely uninterested in and then sort of got engaged with through talking to all these Wall Street analysts who would call me all the time. So I think the microprocessor report analyst was not an analyst like any other kind of analyst. You know, it's it was sort of a... I mean, it was just more technical than a data quest sort of analyst role, and not anything financially oriented like a financial analyst role. So it was like an industry analyst. So I'd say it's probably not too dissimilar from the data quest sort of analyst, except it was more technical. you know, and the and there, there's
well, I was a DataQuest subscriber as well.
Yeah.
I looked at them to find out who my customers were. Mm-hmm. I looked at the microprocessor report to find out who my competitors were and what was good and bad about them.
Right.
And that, you know, that's a both of them were viable markets.
Right. Yep, absolutely. Yep. You know, and there were a number of us out there. We certainly weren't the only game in town. Andrew Allison was out there with his risk newsletter. Dean McCarron and Mike Fibus, who at one point worked for me, and then at one point worked for Instat, and at one point ran their own thing, and now I think they're each running their own thing. You know, probably one of the guys who was closest to me in terms of orientation, who actually I think just died a couple days ago, is Richard Doherty.
I remember that.
He's a really outstanding analyst, just died of a heart attack. Tim Barron, who's again more market-oriented. So there were a bunch of us out there, and we were all sort of friends, but I was the hardcore techie.
Did you ever have a discussion with yourself or your compatriots about, well, maybe we could add, you know, I could get somebody to add a more business-oriented flavor to it and try to cover more of the waterfront?
You know, bewilderingly to me now, I did not have that thought until years after I'd left. Mm-hmm. As I look back on it now, I completely self-identified as the technical microprocessor guy. And maybe a little bit as the business microprocessor guy, but I certainly saw myself as pigeonholed in microprocessors. Mm-hmm. And I left that business at the end of 99. There were many reasons I did that, but looking back on it...
I want to discuss those as we move along. But
looking back on it now, I think, why did I not see that we should have added internet? Mm-hmm. Analysis, right? I was completely fascinated with that, right? And clearly it was the huge growth area. But just the way I thought about myself and the way I thought about the business, it never occurred to me that we could do that sort of lateral extension.
So what were the major milestones? So you started the newsletter in 87 was the first issue, and then you continued with it until 99?
End of 99,
So there was 12 years or something. Right. So what were the major developments, issues, discussion points, you know, throughout that? What were the big things? I mean, you mentioned the risk sys thing. I mean, I'm thinking of sort of major things like that. What were the other, and other items?
It may not have been quite as much, but what it feels like now is 90% of it was Intel versus everybody else. Mm-hmm. And there were a few other things like the emergence of multimedia processing is something that processors were now fast enough to do. Mm-hmm. But certainly at the microprocessor architecture point of view, the big issues was the x86 architecture versus the RISC architecture. How much does architecture really matter? And then all the integration, right? I mean, we started, the headline of the first issue was something like P9 may make 386 obsolete. And this was the other part that I found really fun about it, is it was a leak that somebody sent me, right? I mean, the P9 had not been, it's the 386SX, it had not been announced, but somebody slipped me something, and so now I had a headline. And then one of the later ones was the 386 had a load all instruction that would let you push data into a bunch of the internal registers and make it do things that were completely undocumented, and somebody slipped me the documentation for load all. You know, so that was sort of one of the fun parts of it.
Did you actively solicit that, those sorts of things? Is that?
Yeah. I mean, just not personally, but in the newsletter. We'd say, hey, if you have anything you want to share, send it in. Mm-hmm. And I think there were enough people resentful of Intel that it was easy.
What was your stable of contributing editors? And did it change over time? Did it grow? Did it shrink?
It did change and grow over time, but there are a number of them that, you know, were there for most of the time. For my employees, Lindley Gwennep worked for me for a number of years. He still publishes the newsletter through his own company now. John Wharton did a lot of the early writing. Nick Tredenick did some of the early writing and continued with it. Anything that was funny was either John or Nick. Brian Case is a really outstanding microarchitect who brought like a whole nother level of technical sophistication to it. He had been, I think, one of the AMD 29,000 architects, and you know, really very, very deep microarchitecture guy. Who I think what got Brian involved is Nick was like the most vocal of the anti-risk people. And he had a very opinionated and humorous way of saying things. And Brian called me out of the blue one day and said, can I write an article for you to dispute that crap that Nick Trudenik wrote?
I was going to get to that point. You had these people who worked, for you. Were they employees? Independent contractors?
So Lindley was an employee. Tom Hathill worked for us as an employee. There were half a dozen people on and off over the years who were full-time employees as editors and writers. And then we paid a per-page rate to the...
And what attracted all those per-page authors? Did you pay well, or did they just love your reputation, or what?
I think they liked the soapbox. Mm-hmm. Right. It was an opportunity for them to say what they wanted to say to a community that they cared about.
Interesting. What a delightful way to staff your business with people who are beating down the doors to do your work.
Yeah, and it was really, fortuitous that I ended up in that Asilomar group, because there were a lot of just really exceptional people there that my chance of connecting with otherwise was probably very low,
Right.
And I think part of what made the newsletter work so well in its early years was the mix of people, some of them like John Wharton, who ultimately he and I had something of a falling out and didn't manage to stay friends, which I regret, but he's the funniest person I've ever known, and he had this ability to write these funny technical articles, as did Nick Trudenik, and I think that also gave us sort of a special flavor that
the audience loved it. Yeah.
So what? Again, going back to the beginning in terms of how you really got this launched. You said, either they called you or you called them. How did you get the audience with the Intels or whomever? Did they know who you were? Did you use your contacts in the Asilomar? How did your reputation build to the point where they wanted to meet with you?
Yeah. I don't recall if I had any interaction with them before that first issue. I think the headline of the first issue got Intel's attention, since it was the first leak of their most important new product. And so I'm sure that generated a whole bunch of subscriptions right there. It was hard figuring out how to start from nothing. And so it was really based mostly on those rented mailing lists, where I was just picking job titles and company sizes and things like that. In terms of getting pitched by the companies, I vaguely remember that I made a form letter saying, we're a new publication, please add us to your press list, and I sent it to every known semiconductor company. And I did for many years get hundreds of printed press releases in the mail every week, just to go through them and summarize what seemed like the most important ones. I don't really recall the early days of building that relationship with Intel, but I think, we did, really the thing I'm most proud of out of that whole thing is that I think I quickly built a relationship of somebody who, yes, was opinionated, but was also, didn't shoot from the hip and was knowledgeable and could be trusted. Mm-hmm. That relationship did not last with Intel, but but early on, that was the case. Mm-hmm. And I think the architects at Intel and all the other risk companies and all the other semiconductor companies loved the fact that finally there was a reporter who actually cared about any of the details that they were so proud of, right? Because nobody else was asking them the kinds of questions we were asking them.
All right.
How did you bootstrap the business from a business point of view? How did you manage the circulation and printing and...
Yeah. It was tough. It was tough. I had no capital and no savings. There were a few people who made small investments. Rich Belgard was one. John Wakerly, I think, was one. Bernard may have put in a little bit of money. So there's a little bit of capital. I did borrow some money. I did what I think is the only flat-out fraudulent activity of my life, which is what we had actually financed the first year of the company by not paying ourselves and living on credit cards. Then, when I went to get a second mortgage on my house, I discovered that I had, by doing that, it would have complete, you know, that they were not interested in a tax return that showed no income. But I discovered I could go down to the stationery store and buy a blank W-2 form and put whatever I wanted on it. And so so I created a W-2 and a tax return for what I thought they wanted to hear and got a second mortgage. That was in 1988.
I guess the banks aren't allowed to go to the IRS for verification, are they?
Yeah, well, I don't think you could get away with that today. And then I found a guy through the Newsletter Association, a guy named Gary Strickler, who had a company in Canada. And he had, it was basically a financing scheme where he would pay all the costs of dropping your direct mail in the mail. He then got all the money that came back until he had gotten everything he put in plus 10%. And you did owe him if it didn't all come back. Mm-hmm. So, but at least in the early days, every one of those campaigns did cover itself. Mm-hmm. He had a great business because he made 10% interest on like 60 days.
Right.
but he was willing to provide me capital in a way that nobody else was, because in an odd way, he sort of took the value of that mailing campaign as his equity, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, he had to look at it and believe there was going to be enough orders coming back. You know, over the years, I think as we saturated the market, we were unable to build circulation profitably through promotion. So mm-hmm. the promotion largely stopped and became word of mouth.
Mm-hmm. Was the peak in the thousands of subscribers?
I think so. Yeah, I think it was a few thousand.
And how long did it sustain at that level?
I think through the second half of the 90s. Mm-hmm. And actually, by that point, I had sold the business. So I actually ran it much longer than I owned it. So I started the business in 87. In 1990, we moved to Sonoma County, and I adopted my first kid. And about 3 months into raising a child, I said, you know, I don't really, you know, there was like a payroll that I had to borrow money. We were using money from more, the fact that we were in between houses, we were using that money to cover a payroll. And I said, you know, this doesn't feel good. Why don't I sell it? And so we actually did sell the business to Ziff-Davis, which at the time, you know, that this was back when, you know, Computer Shopper was like that thick and PC Magazine was this giant business. And we were the technical experts, right? So, but they never really quite knew what to do with us. And after a few years, they sold us to Connors, which owned Instat. I think the Ziff-Davis sale was 92 and the Connors sale was 98. So through all that, the owners changed, right? And the sources of capital changed, but pretty much the business kept going as it was.
So how is it that you decided to move the business to Sonoma County instead of here in the valley?
Because I couldn't afford 5 acres in Woodside. That is, I was determined to live in the country. And the business had not been nearly successful enough to live in the country anywhere near Silicon Valley. And so we actually looked at moving south towards Santa Cruz. You know, I think it was all those summers of my childhood being on a beautiful camp up in the mountains, you know, and I liked a lot of things about the valley, but the density and lack of sort of natural beauty around you, you know, I just, something in me just wanted to live in the country. So we ended up moving to Sonoma County in 1990, as I said. And I have to say that while as a lifestyle location, it is a better place than I ever could have imagined, and I absolutely recommend it. I think it's a totally wonderful place to be. However, if you want to do startups, I wouldn't go there.
it must have been a strain to get back and forth to all your customers and your sources.
Well, so by that point, I had Lindley down here, right? So he was in an editorial office down here. Mm-hmm. So my model was he can be here. He can do all the sort of frequent stuff here. I can do phone and fax. I can come down every week or two. And it sort of worked, but it is different, you know. And I think the main thing you lose is you don't have frequent spontaneous meetings. And you know, if there's a talk one evening and you say, well, that might be sort of interesting. Well, driving 10 minutes and driving 2 hours are very different thresholds for deciding to go to that talk.
Right.
And so that sort of thing did make it hard.
So let's talk about the microprocessor forum. You sort of touched on it. Talk more in detail about how it actually got started, what actually pushed you over the edge, and how did you decide sort of between the executive and the IEEE low-end model, how did that all evolve?
It was one of these ideas that just wouldn't go away. I decided to do it and then decided that it was way too much for me to cope with at least three times. Mm-hmm. But it just wouldn't go away. And so actually the first one we did, Stuart called his conference Agenda 89. So the conference in 88 was called Agenda 89. So not being super creative, I called mine Microprocessors 89. So the very first microprocessor forum, which was in 88, was called Microprocessors 89. Then in 89, I think we just switched to calling it Microprocessor Forum 89, not having this confusing year thing. Really, the genesis of that was all these RISC microprocessors and feeling like without being able to put those people up on stage together, it was really hard to sort anything out. And then, you know, a couple of my colleagues had said, you know, the microprocessor industry doesn't have a decent conference. I don't think hot chips existed at that point. Mm-hmm. Hot chips is sort of the only other thing that's close.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt like having gone to the executive conferences and having gone to the engineering conferences, that there was just this huge gap in terms of how pleasant they were to attend and how much of a sort of quality social function they were. And so I felt like you could do something in the middle. And also in terms of the content, you know, you can go to ISSCC and you can see every last intimate detail about some new chip and have no idea why anybody would want it, mm-hmm. Or who they're going to sell it to, you know. Or you can, you know, go to the conferences of the other extreme that are just all marketing fluff. And so content-wise, I also wanted to do something different. And, you know, another one of these radical things we did that I didn't think of as a radical thing, it was just seemed to me like the natural thing to do, is we told all the companies that we would not accept marketing people as presenters. And that we wanted to review their slides.
Mm.
And so that led to a lot of fights because we said, you know, you can have a slide or two of the marketing values here, but it has to be fundamentally technical presentation given by a fundamentally technical person. And, you know, that really did give it sort of a special character, and for whatever reason, none of the other conference producers had the guts or the desire to tell the semiconductor companies that we weren't going to let their marketing people speak.
So what did the first one look like? How many people? How long? Would you decide this is a 1 day, 5 day?
It was one day. We did it at what I think was then the Red Lion in San Jose, right off the freeway. I think we had about 200 people.
Mm-hmm. And was it purely CISC versus RISC focus?
You know, I don't know that it was. I mean, I think it was more about microprocessor architecture. And here's three different RISC ones, and here's a CISC one. And I actually haven't pulled up that first year's program lately. And a lot of it was also, I mean, really the majority of the presentations were product announcement focused, right? I mean, we really also tried to maintain not quite as hard a line as ISSCC did for a long time, where you couldn't have ever talked about it before, but we wanted it to be the first substantive disclosure.
Mm-hmm. How did you recruit your speakers if you couldn't go through the marketing department, or you had to?
Everything was arranged through the marketing department.
Yeah.
We just told the marketing department that the speaker we wanted was the chief architect.
Yeah.
And, you know, and they would usually push back. We'd say, if you don't want to participate, that's fine.
did that effort detract from the newsletter? Because you're trying to do them both at the same time. The newsletter was still pretty young.
I think it's always been my biggest challenge in my little businesses is that I do too much and one thing detracts from another. But I think we managed to pull it off. And I think the newsletter built the audience that enabled the conference to be successful. And the conference.
There's a lot of synergy there, yeah.
And the conference produced the profit that enabled the newsletter to keep going.
Uh-huh.
So they really they probably could not have survived independently.
So how did the conference evolve? What did it sort of grow and change? And tell me about how it evolved.
Now, Microprocessor Forum evolved quite a bit. I mean, it of course went from 1 day to 2 days for the main conference program, and then we started adding in a third and I think even a fourth day of seminars where we would teach a half day or all day. One of our analysts or mm-hmm. editors would you know present a whole presentation on something. The risk versus stuff kept up for a long time. I think in the mid-90s we did start getting into more DSP sorts of things and multimedia kinds of things, and we actually had a lot of questions about, you know, so should we have a section on DSPs? Should we start a DSP conference? Do the people who care about 486s care about DSPs, you know, and I don't know that we ever really answered those things. We did let the DSPs in a little bit, but not in a super comprehensive way. Jeff Beer at BDTI, another mm-hmm. one of these sort of technical analysts, sort of became our DSP affiliate. We started getting a little bit more into sort of PC architecture, really led by what Intel was doing, right? Because Intel mm-hmm. had completely changed the idea of what it meant to be a microprocessor company, right? Mm-hmm. They'd taken it from, we're building these chips and we ship them out the door and other people figure out what to do with them, to, you know, we essentially own the computer industry and we're going to mm-hmm. design the computers and these other people can build them and wrap sheet metal around them. Mm-hmm. So the whole design of the computer sort of became part of our coverage. Mm-hmm. And we actually did spin off two other conferences, neither of which survived. But we did spin off an embedded conference at one point because we felt like the embedded stuff was just too different.
Mm-hmm. That was before its time.
Yeah, and then we spun off a PC tech conference. Mm-hmm. And I think that one we had just stretched ourselves too thin at that point. And there were other players who had some cachet in that. So we also pulled back out of that. And the Microprocessor Forum is the thing that survived.
How did you decide you weren't going to, that the spinoffs weren't going to work and you ought to cut back, you know, cut them off? They weren't attracting attendees or speakers or what?
I think the amount of marketing we had to do for the people we got, and you know, by that point I was pretty burned out. The business I felt like never had great business leaders. Ziff-Davis really didn't know what to do with us, and Connors knew only slightly more. And I think the business was marginally profitable, and each of these things required investments. And Ziff-Davis, you know, at the time we were ramping up the PC Tech Forum, Ziff-Davis was noticing that the PC industry was collapsing, so they were sort of scaling back on a lot of their investments. So it was just a combination, I think, of things, but you know, probably a lot of it was lack of support from our corporate owners to invest in multiple years of mm-hmm. building something up to the point where it was profitable. If you're lucky, you can start a conference and have it be profitable the first year like we did.
Did you who were, you personally or your gang who were trying to bootstrap these conferences have to build special relationships with the manufacturers or the people who invented and wanted to describe their products? And yeah, how did those relationships work? Did you have an Intel specialist and a Spark specialist and whatever?
Yeah, at that point, we'd already been engaged with all these companies to talk to them about articles. So we were working, you know, it was always through the PR department who would then connect us with the marketing people, who would then connect us with the technical people. In the case of Intel, they actually were analyst relations people. Most semiconductor companies did not have those, mm-hmm. but Intel did. They were about 50-50 on being helpful or hindrances. And so we basically said, hey, we're doing this conference. Do you want to present something? Here's the rules. And and we were able to get everybody to participate because I think they didn't have a lot of options.
Well, at one point, the reputation of the newsletter was strong enough that it would support the same customer base doing it in person at a forum.
Right. I think it's the events appeal to more people in some ways than the newsletter does because A lot of people, I think, came to the events more for the hallways than for the presentation.
Indeed.
Right? They come because the community is there. And so I think that's really what made the events take off, combined with the fact that it became the major place where new microprocessors were announced each year, and that for people who were looking for more training sort of content, we had seminars where we would give them a couple days of intensive training. The pinnacle of the microprocessor forum was, I guess that was 1999, when both I-64 and RAM bus were announced.
Mm-hmm.
Two disasters. but that were a big deal at the time, and which generated a lot of interest, and which also generated a lot of contention and ultimately left to my leaving. But so actually, if I could just take a quick pit stop and then I can go into that.
You were about to suggest the same thing.
Good to bring.
Okay, so where do we leave off? We were talking a bit about...
We were talking about microprocessor forum. An Intel and I-64, and then
the relationship that you were building up with all of the the various.
One of the difficult things about this business was that our most important sources of information and our most important customers were the same, and yet a lot of our reputation came from being critical and being willing to call it as we saw it, right? So this always made the semiconductor companies a little uncomfortable. And I had some experiences that just sort of felt unclean to me. Like I did some, the semiconductor companies would hire me for consulting from time to time. But one of the consulting arrangements I did, I actually happened to see some papers that somebody had left on the table when everyone left the room. And I went and looked at their agenda and found that the whole consulting agreement was really a sham, that they didn't care what I said. It was a way to pay me to try to influence my opinion. And at that point, I said, this doesn't feel quite right. And then Intel started getting more and more aggressive with us. One of the memorable meetings with Dave House was he called me up one day and asked me to come in and see him. And he had there on the table everything we had ever printed, all of our compilations, all of our newsletters with Post-its on all of it, and a count of how many of them were about x86 processors and how many of them were about RISC processors. And showed me that I had three times as much content about RISC processors as about x86 processors. And clearly, that was showed that I was biased and it was totally bogus because that was not what the market was like. And I said, Dave, this is not about how many you sell. It's about architectures. You have one. They have 10. That was just classic Intel, right? They would look for any way to exert pressure.
Mm-hmm.
And
were there any other... notably egregious.
Yes, yeah, we'll get there. There was a huge variation in how open the people at Intel were in sort of the PR analyst relations. There were a couple of really outstanding people. Karen Alter and Nancy Pressel were two PR people who both totally got it. They knew that we had to be critical to be credible. And, and if I said something they thought was a cheap shot, they'd let me know, right? But they wouldn't then stop briefing me, right?
Mm-hmm.
There were some other people who followed them. Mike Green is one that came to mind, who basically viewed his job as, appeared to view his job as controlling our opinions and what we could write and taking retribution when he didn't like what we did. And that became very much a pattern. And they would cancel subscriptions, they'd cancel conference presentations, they'd Andy's take no prisoners style, it was a real thing, when they viewed us as the enemy, they treated us like the enemy. And it was just unpleasant, and I got to a point where I said, I'm not gonna engage with Intel anymore. And that's what ultimately led to me leaving Microprocessor Report, because there was no way to do that and not engage with Intel anymore.
Mm-hmm.
Although I was also really tired of feeling like a voyeur and wanting to be in one of these businesses, not writing about them. and also had gotten to a point where I had felt like microprocessors had matured to a point where, while the further hardware advances were gonna be valuable and enabling, nothing at that point was being held back by hardware. Everything was being held back by software, user interface, and that the microprocessor architecture just, to me, ceased to be an interesting place. It was like a solved problem in some sense. But so a couple other microprocessor forum stories. I think it was 97 or 98. AMD had now gotten into the x86 business. I was probably a little bit guilty of being an AMD cheerleader, although I tried to keep things very balanced. And they had K5, I think it was. They had some processor that they were announcing. And we had Sanders as the keynote. And then he was the president of AMD at the time, and one of the industry's more colorful figures. And then the first thing on the printed program was an Intel microprocessor announcement. I forget which x86 thing this was. But we'd always known, and this again where I just wasn't as sensitive as I should have been to the politics here, the AMD, there was a new Intel. So on the program, it showed Sanders as the keynote, and then this AMD K5, I think it was the first presentation. But Intel was announcing 686 or something big. And so we'd actually given them the first slot that was between Sanders' keynote and the AMD presentation, but we didn't put it in the printed program because Intel didn't want the name of the thing published yet. So it hadn't occurred to me that to AMD, this was going to look to them like they had a keynote slot followed by a presentation, and then I was sliding Intel into the middle. And so the day before the presentation, I'm giving an all-day seminar. Somebody comes, pulls me out of my seminar, which I'm in the middle of presenting, and says, "Jerry Sanders wants to talk to you." Because the printed programs for the actual event had just come out showing this Intel talk in between his keynote and his microprocessor presentation. So he gets me on the phone and he says, "I am just goddamn tired of sucking hind tit to Intel." And it took me about 15 minutes to calm him down to the point where they didn't pull the presentation. But then the last straw with Intel was, this must have been Microprocessor Forum 99. So this was the really big one where i64 and RAM bus were both getting big technical disclosures. And Nick is just, he has an incredible talent for making fun of people. And he was very skeptical of the whole IA64 program, and he also felt like it was really a management failure at Intel. It was not a technical failure, it was a management failure. And he wrote a fairly pointed article that mentioned nobody by name, didn't mention companies by name, but it was pretty easy to read through it as basically an attack on Albert Yu, probably. I'm not sure that it was all Albert, but it was basically an attack on Intel technical management without mentioning any names. But of course, Intel was somewhat incensed. And so I had another one of these long series of conversations with upset people and getting them to calm down, and they were going to pull the presentation and finally convince them to come do the presentation anyway. And so it seemed like that had sort of calmed down. But one of the traditions at the Microprocessor Forum each year was that Nick Tredenick gave an awards ceremony, which was a very tongue-in-cheek, sort of humorous awards ceremony. And I had made the gigantic mistake of telling Nick that Intel had threatened to pull out of the conference when they saw his article, which he worked into his awards ceremony. And I happened to be standing there in the back of the room next to the reporter from the Wall Street Journal, I forget who it was at the time, who saw Nick say this and looked at me, and the Intel PR person was there too. Like, these two people are looking at me saying, "Boy, you're in big trouble now." Again, everybody seemed a little upset, but nothing much happened. And then the fact that Intel had threatened to pull out was in that reporter's Wall Street Journal column the next morning. And that's the last time I ever spoke to Intel. They cut us off from embargoes. They would no longer brief microprocessor report under embargo. They generally wouldn't take phone calls. They just became completely opaque. And at that point, I decided I would never again have anything to do with Intel. So it was just, I can see it from their point of view, right? I mean, they were a very big business, a lot of money at stake. you know, I was a thorn in their side, and, you know, if you have a take no prisoners strategy, you know, you do everything you can to kill the thorn. you know, that was...
Well, you had a good run up until that point.
Yes, we did.
And as you said, it was beginning to not be the issue of the day.
Right.
So were the sales to, you talked about the sale to Ziff-Davis as being sort of a practical economic kind of thing, and then they sold it to Connors. Was the management of either company did it become an issue? Did they try to control what you were doing in any way? Did you feel like you were still a relatively independent operation? How did that?
We were relatively independent, I think, but of course they control the capital, and mm-hmm. we were trying to do new stuff that required capital. So their control really was in our ability to do new stuff.
Mm-hmm.
You know, the business was never a hugely profitable business. In fact, in the early days of Ziff-Davis owning it, we were trying to launch new conferences and stuff. You know, it consumed a modest amount of cash,
mm-hmm.
But it was a substantially bigger business by the time Connors bought it, mm-hmm. and they were actually a much better match in that Instat was at least conceivably a match for the right kind of firm. But I don't think they had any very strong management or really knew how to incorporate us.
Mm-hmm.
By the early 2000s. Their leader and founder, whose name I just went, but Jack
Beadle.
Beadle. He had been starting to fade out of the picture too.
Yeah.
And I think he was the main instigator.
Yeah.
So how long did the Connor thing stick with?
I think Connor owned it for close to 10 years. I'm not sure. And then they mm-hmm. sold it to Lindley when they decided to shut it down. Lindley bought it back from them, and he had been running his own little analyst firm since leaving Microprocessor Report, so he had his whole infrastructure there ready to just take it over, and he has continued to run little conferences too, although he's taken a different approach to it. You know, I took a very hard line, no sponsorship, no advertising, everybody who attends pays, purely editorial. He's doing a somewhat more traditional semiconductor industry thing where people pay for the right to present and the attendees get to come for free, so it's a conference, but on a completely different model.
Mm-hmm. So how did that, so you left in 99.
The very end of 99, yeah.
The major instigator was, well, it sounds like a couple of things, sort of the decay and change and innovation and so forth, getting a little bit tired of the whole thing, cut off with Intel, sort of everything came together, and you said this is the time to step aside. So was that... with the idea of, okay, and here's what I'm going to do next, or I'm getting out of this and then I need to figure out what the next step is?
No, I already had an idea. You know, at the time, in the last couple of years of Microprocessor Report, information appliances were the big thing, right?
Mm-hmm.
Everybody was saying we're going to have all these dedicated things that are going to do different things for us. And I had been, always been a hobby photographer, and it actually built one of my first sizable websites when my kids were young, and we spent a couple summers at Lake Tahoe, and I built a website about Lake Tahoe, and at that point this was all film and then getting it scanned, and you know, and so then and I said, geez, you know, this was sort of fun, but it's really tedious having to deal with the film, and then digital cameras got up to a megapixel, and I said, oh wow, they've now reached this magic threshold where the quality is good mm-hmm. enough. But then the experience on the PC trying to do anything with digital photos was just horrifying. Mm-hmm. I mean, even for me as a pretty technical guy, I was having a really hard time figuring it all out. So I said, hey, there's got to be an opportunity here for an information appliance that is your photography world,
mm-hmm.
right? You just connect your camera to it. It sucks in your pictures. It stores them. It'll send them off to get printed if you want. You can view them if you want. And Stuart Alsop, who had been a fellow newsletter publisher, was now a venture capitalist at New Enterprise Associates, and so he agreed to provide us with our initial funding, and we started a company called PhotoTablet. And if you look today at a iPad running Apple Photos,
mm-hmm.
you have something very close to what we wanted to do, but we were a good decade ahead of the point at which it could be done at a price point that people would accept it.
Right.
And so after writing the core of the software and building some prototype hardware and doing some market research, you know, we concluded that our what we could sell it for and what people would buy it for curves, you know, were like many years out before those were going to cross. And so at that point, we said, well, while we really like the idea of an information appliance, we don't see it as an economically viable model at this point. Another interesting thing we found is we did consumer studies. So we did, you know, focus group sorts of things. And while as an analyst, I had been there beating up on the PC, saying, you know, these PCs are too hard to use and they have all these problems. And, you know, but then when we took ordinary non-technical people and we asked them about their PCs, they assumed that all the problems were theirs, not the PCs. That they were just too dumb to figure it out. And they had already made an investment in it, so they had no interest in investing in a device that was an alternate to the PC. So that was another thing that said, you know, this is going to be a tough market.
So you were actually going to try to build a piece of hardware,
right?
A tablet that was, that's a major undertaking in a very different world than what you had been working in.
Right. Well, it was always the sort of thing I liked to do, right? And
yeah.
And it was at a time, right, 1999, there was a lot of venture capital available. There was a lot of enthusiasm for information appliances. You know.
You'd have to hire a whole team.
Oh, yeah. We raised $2.5 million. We had 15 people.
Okay.
We were in business for about 22 months. Mm-hmm. You know, we had done the standard venture capital thing of you raise enough money to sort of build the product and then you do a Series B to bring it to market.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we needed our Series B in the fall of 2001 when everything in the digital photo space was struggling and, in fact, the whole venture community was basically not doing B rounds for anything.
Mm-hmm.
And we were very lucky that we had been engaged with Adobe trying to get them to invest because Adobe had an investment arm.
Mm-hmm.
And then just about the time we were getting really frustrated trying to raise the Series B, Adobe came to us and said, you know, we really like what you're doing, but it's way too close to what we should be doing for us to invest in you. How about we just buy the company?
Mm-hmm. To do what? To continue it or to put it out of their competition?
No, so at that point we had switched from it's not a tablet, it's a piece of PC software.
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, they had a huge franchise with Photoshop, but Photoshop is a one photo at a time sort of thing. It does nothing for you for the 10,000 photos or 100,000 photos you might have, right? And we were all photo organization oriented. So the product actually got first marketed by Adobe as Photoshop Album. And I was the product manager on that. And then...
So you actually became
I worked for Adobe for 5 years. Hmm. Got that first version of Photoshop Album out. It was my first real exposure to the job of a product manager in a big company, which I found very frustrating because, you know, there's this idea of, oh, we listen to the customers and then the customers tell us what to build. And I came in from the point of view of, I have a vision for what this product should be. So I was not a great cultural match with the Adobe product management world. But I got along really well with the guy who was running engineering at the time, Greg Gilley, who's now senior engineering guy at Apple. And I said, look, you and I both know I've got a lot of ideas for features you're going to want in this. So let me build a little research team. And I'll just build these features for you, even though product management isn't asking for them.
Mm-hmm.
And then if when I'm done, product management doesn't want to ship them, then you should fire me. So we did some of the earliest work in organizing photos by visual similarity, doing stacks of similar photos, doing face recognition to organize photos. I went out and licensed the core technologies from other companies and then brought them in and had my little team build mm-hmm. a user experience around them. And, you know, I look back at that now and I kick myself for not having found a way to be happy at it. Because it paid me vastly better than anything I've done since and was easier than anything I've done since. But again, there was just something about that big company environment where I felt like I couldn't get very much done that just tortured me.
Mm-hmm.
And the people who stay at Adobe for a long time tend to be the people who are comfortable with going to work and someone's telling them what they're working on. They're not sort of entrepreneurial. The more entrepreneurial somebody is, I think the shorter time they last at a company like Adobe, because it's just a conflict of the way your mind works.
Right.
And I really wanted to get Adobe into the consumer photo sharing business. And we built what I think would have been a killer system. It's codenamed Cloud 9. it very much like what the very best of the photo sharing stuff is today. We had this built in 2004. Mm-hmm. And at the time, Adobe management viewed the consumer market as uninteresting. Their statement was all consumer price points trend to zero, and we're going to be an enterprise software company. We're just milking that creative pro market to build our enterprise software company, an effort that completely failed. They've now, I think, pretty much bailed on being an enterprise software company and are back serving consumers and creative pros. We could have had them 10 years ahead of where they are today in the photo sharing infrastructure, but they just didn't see it, and I found it too frustrating. They ended up canceling our whole photo sharing project in order to do a premium SKU of Photoshop, right? Basically, they looked and said, you know, what can we do that's going to give us a boost in next year's revenue numbers, right? Mm-hmm. So and the short-term sort of drive-by shooting was vastly more appealing than a strategic mm-hmm. new venture.
Can you describe how your own personal mindset changed from the enterprise serving microprocessor forum and newsletter mm-hmm. to the consumer serving photo sharing?
Now that I look back on it, it's a pretty radical change for sure. I've always just been a curious person and interested in things, and I guess to me it was the same kind of thing in that because I was designing microprocessor-based stuff, I had this thing in my head of what I wanted that newsletter to be. And because I'd been doing lots of digital photography and studying information appliances and photo management, I had this thing in my head of what I wanted it to be. I was not a good consumer guy in that I was not driven to go listen to other people.
Were the consumer.
I was using myself as the proxy, and I probably was not a great proxy. We did manage to build a really great team. Lori Vertelny was our UI person. She's now back at Apple. She was one of the early people at Apple. And she got us into doing consumer tests and actually really understanding what it meant to build things for a consumer and test it with them to find out if the dogs would actually eat the dog food.
Mm-hmm. So did any of that actually make it? I mean, Adobe eventually got into that kind of market.
Right.
So whether it be Lightroom or Elements or cloud stuff or
so
whatever.
So our actual software lives on today as the organizer mode of Photoshop Elements only in the PC version. They didn't do it on the Mac version because they didn't want to compete with iPhoto.
Uh-huh. Which is dead.
Yes, which is now dead. So basically they had, from Photoshop, they created Photoshop Elements basically to have an affordable price point product, right?
Right.
And then, but then with the consumer world, they got, once you've taken a couple thousand digital photos, the problem ceases to be, what do I do with this one photo? Mm-hmm. It becomes, where is that photo?
Right.
Or I want to do something with 50 photos, how do I do that? Mm-hmm. Right? So they had the editing thing, this became the organizing and sort of crafty thing, right? Mm-hmm. They went down a path that I found completely uninteresting, which is the sort of scrapbooky, mm-hmm. I want to add stickers around my pictures little captions of what people are saying and all that. I'm much more of a traditional hardcore photographer. So Lightroom is really the product I wanted to build.
Mm-hmm.
I think Lightroom's a fantastic product. I use it every day.
Mm-hmm.
Lightroom is way beyond the vision of what I wanted to build. And actually, on my website now, I have there is a Lightroom plugin that has a matching WordPress plugin where you can actually create a collection in Lightroom and then one click say, I want this on my website, and everything happens. And that is the core of what we were trying to do in 2004, except you didn't have to have your own website. But the paradigm that I believe then and I believe now is the right one is that you want your photos stored locally,
mm-hmm.
and you want to manage them locally. And when you want them shared somewhere on the web, you want to do that through a local interface which just knows how to talk to that stuff in the cloud and makes it all happen.
Mm-hmm.
Were the seeds of Lightroom extant at the time you were working on your idea? And did you have interaction with the people who planted those seeds?
Just a little bit, very, very early. Lightroom was started by a guy named Mark Hamburg, who was the engineering manager for Photoshop for many, many years, or the technical leader or something. And you know, I think the impetus for Lightroom came from the fact that Photoshop had been fairly widely adopted by photographers, but it really turned into a graphic arts tool. And 90% at least of what was in it was irrelevant to most photographers, yet all that complexity got in the way of learning to use it. Mm-hmm. And then it wasn't solving a lot of the problems the photographers had, like dealing with more than one picture at a time. And Mark was an active photographer, and you know, and Greg Gilley, who's the engineering director, you know, they shared a vision for this product that could be built.
Turn it off.
So in the early days of our product, Lightroom was like a science experiment. So there were a few people working on it. It had no real strategy. It was being written in Lua, which was first thing that Adobe had done in a long time that wasn't C++. So it just had this very science experiment sort of feel to it. There were pieces of it that were working. They had a bunch of ideas. Clearly, my photo organizer had been relegated as the consumer hobbyist thing. There was Bridge, which is really a file browser, you know, and I think should have been killed and replaced with our stuff. And there was one attempt to do that, but we lost. And then there was Lightroom going on. We were maybe 2 or 3 years into it when Apple announced Aperture, which was going after exactly the same concept as Lightroom. And it was fascinating to be inside Adobe then, because there were a certain group of people within Adobe, I think predominantly engineers, that said, it's over, we're screwed. Apple got there ahead of us, it's gonna be theirs. And much to their credit, the senior product management people came in and said, bullshit, this is our market to win, we're gonna kill them. Adobe pre-announced Lightroom 6 months before it was ready to ship. They'd never done that before, but they had to do something to blunt Apple's entry. And here we are, how many years later? Lightroom is the premier product. Mm-hmm. Apple has abandoned their product. And the guy who is the director of engineering at Adobe is now the director of engineering at Apple.
Deeper pockets.
And Mark Hamburg, who created that product originally, actually became a Microsoft fellow, and I think lasted between 1 and 2 years before he ended up back at Adobe. And Mark Polliger, who was the engineering manager for many years on Photoshop after Mark, is now one of the senior engineering people at Google.
Have you maintained relationships with these?
You know, Facebook-level relationships for the most part. So, you know, Adobe was a really interesting experience. You know, I think I could have accomplished a lot more there if I had been a big company guy, but I didn't understand how to operate within a big company. Didn't really get it until I left that I think if you're really going to be successful at a big company, you have to not be pursuing your vision, but their vision. And I was always trying to pursue my vision.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So before we get sort of on the next stage, I want to step back and make sure that on the whole microprocessor report and that sort of thing, is there any stories, people, events, situations, transitions that we glossed over or completely missed? Talked about the evolution of the microprocessor report. So maybe you could relate sort of you left microprocessor report. We found out what you did next. What happened to microprocessor report?
Right.
Give us a summary and sort of wrap that piece.
So microprocessor report, you know, we kept looking for ways to build more revenue. So we tried to spin off these other conferences. We ended up doing a lot of sort of reprint books where we'd compile a bunch of our articles into one thing. And then we tried to do some of these, you know, $1,000, $2,000, $3,000 book-like things like DataQuest would do, right? Mm-hmm. Where it seems like if it's of lower quality and poorly printed, then instead of selling it for $50, you can sell it for $5,000. We made some progress on that, you know, and the company was decently profitable. At the time I left, you know, I really sort of lost track. It was really being run as part of Instat at the time. And I think Microprocessor Forum kept going for a few years, but then they shut it down. And then the newsletter kept going for a few years more, and then they shut it down. So I didn't really stay very engaged with it. It was really sort of remarkable to me how I'd cared so much about microprocessors for so long that it's like overnight, I didn't care at all. Mm-hmm. They were just completely irrelevant, you know. And it really drove home to me also the point that, you know, all the other reporters were making was nobody really cares what microprocessor is in their thing anymore, because I found that I didn't even care. I'm going to buy the next Apple thing that's the model that I want, you know. And then it's phones and iPads, and I don't even know what processors in these things, you know.
As a computer architectural intellectual purist, did it bother you when Apple chose Intel over their own and their others?
Well, I think Keith Diefendorf was part of that. Keith worked for me for a while. He was the architect of the Motorola 88000, and then ended up as a microprocessor guy at Apple. One of the things that I came to realize towards the end of my career at Microprocessor Report is that Intel's strength was fundamentally economic, not technical. Right? While there was a tremendous amount of technical strength there, the investment that they had in fab capacity meant that they were going to win no matter what. You know, if some other design turned out to be the winning design, they'd go buy it, right? Mm-hmm. But nobody else could actually service all the customers or build the things, you know. If I were to have continued with Microprocessor Report, I think I would have ended up getting more and more business oriented, because that was sort of what was becoming to me the interesting part of it. I'd stopped caring about pipelines, right? Mm-hmm. Particularly once it started becoming evident that, okay, so if you do everything right and you follow all these risk things and it in fact really is all better, right, that maybe you gain a 2x speed improvement, which Intel can gain if they can get to the next process with an old architecture 18 months sooner. Mm-hmm. So you know no amount of microarchitecture was going to make you win. And then furthermore, as people started looking more deeply at, you know, can I use all of the smart implementation techniques that the RISC guys came up with, but build a machine that does x86 instructions? And they said, yeah, I can do that, right? So the whole reason for the battle sort of went away. You know,
I mean, Intel ended up embedding most of those good ideas in their architecture, right?
Right. I mean, what it came down to is you can use those ideas as internal architecture, and they don't really need to necessarily be there in your instruction set. Mm-hmm. And that the value of compatibility in the instruction set overwhelms everything else.
Right.
So let me think. There was something else that was leading me to other things about Microprocessor Report.
Now, Microprocessor Report, I mean, what is Lindley Group publishing now then?
So Lindley Group publishes the Microprocessor Report, and they run a number of conferences, and then he does a number of these sort of multi-client study sort of reports, I think, more oriented around things like network infrastructure, processors, and embedded processors and DSPs. Peter Christie, who actually was president of MDR for a while when I was trying to get somebody else to run the business, he runs a firm called Net's Edge or something. He has an analyst firm now that does internet, web, same sort of thing we used to do for the same sort of thing I think I probably should have kept doing. So there have been people that have taken it in various directions.
So the report never died. It just moved from one owner to another, and it changed, morphed.
Is the subscription rate roughly the same?
I think this is its 29th year, which is pretty amazing.
And it's still running in thousands, not tens of thousands or hundreds.
I would bet it's lower than it used to be, and I don't know what the price currently is.
Well, sure, because the issue of the day is apps.
Right. Right. Although not for the people who are making
Indeed,
silicon there are for embedded things.
There
right?
are yeah. there are silicon people, but there's a lot more apps people now.
Right. Yeah. Right.
Yeah. Okay. So we covered the NPR and that sort of thing. Okay. So you You went to Adobe, but you're living in Sonoma County at this point,
so we moved
right?
to Sonoma County in 90. So I lived there for 10 years doing microprocessor report. And then we started the company in Sonoma County, Phototablet. Uh-huh. We were then called Phototablet, and it was renamed Photivo once we decided that tablets weren't going to be a part of it.
Right.
You know, and that business only lived for 2 years before we sold that to Adobe. So mm-hmm. it was end of 2001 that we sold that to Adobe. So we had an office with about 15 people in Santa Rosa. And I would come down typically for 2 or 3 days every 2 weeks. Initially because I felt like if I wasn't physically present in a meeting in San Jose, I had very little influence, like being mm-hmm. the one guy on the TV in the room full of 12 people.
Right.
It was really hard. By the end of my 5 years, I concluded I didn't have any influence no matter how often I went to San Jose.
And that was, so you continued to work out of the office
and that was when I left.
Yeah. And never actually occupied the downtown headquarters or whatever.
No, okay. Not more than a couple of days every couple of weeks.
Right.
Was that just a remote site, or was it telecommuting?
The Adobe Santa Rosa?
Yeah.
Yeah, originally it was just us, but then they bought a company in Novato, and they moved them up there, and so it was like a little Adobe remote office. It's now been closed, and the few people that are still Adobe employees work from home.
Yeah.
And then all the products that group built are now being maintained in India.
Interesting.
Okay, so the day came, you said, I can't handle this anymore. Time to move on. You know what you're moving on to, or are you just leaving?
So I did not know what I was moving on to. So this was 2006. And so, you know, I started out as a really hardcore technical guy. I mean, at one point I could write 8080 machine code. I didn't need an assembler. and I'd gotten as far as 68,000, you know. By the time I had gone into the microprocessor report and microprocessor forum, I was like not actually building my own stuff anymore, right? And then when I hired software people for Photiva, they were writing C++, which I didn't know at all. And so all I could do was advise them on what it should do, not how they should write it. Mm-hmm. And then Adobe was that same sort of thing. But as we had gone down this path of building online services, ever since the birth of the web, I've had a huge passion for the web. And so I got involved with trying to say, you know, what can we do here with the web and all of this? Let me get my train of thought back again.
So you're leaving Adobe and
So through being engaged with the online services stuff at Adobe, I'd become exposed to the Ruby on Rails technology. And through my hobby web work, I had built a bunch of database-driven websites, one called Boating SF, which was a big resource site for
San
Francisco.
That's the one that looks on the bay.
Yeah.
It figures out where everything is.
Yeah, it's got a whole bunch of stuff. I actually sold that a year ago.
I had heard that was instrumental in a tanker hitting. The archive had useful information that nobody else did.
That's right. I had a receiver that was recording ship positions. So I'd gotten to know the Ruby on Rails technology and gotten myself a little bit technical enough that I could build stuff again. You know, and to me that was really important to satisfaction because, mm-hmm. you know, I found it a sort of frustrating place to be trying to define a product and then have an engineering team whose code I couldn't touch when I wanted to go and just tweak things, you know, or just go build something. So I basically, after I left Adobe, I immersed myself for about 6 months in trying to become a basically competent Ruby on Rails developer. I think I got to be reasonably competent. I built apps for a couple of local companies. Still found it somewhat discouraging that seemed that the 25-year-olds were a lot better than I was.
So 2 minutes. 20 seconds on Ruby on Rails. What was unique about it? What was interesting about it?
So Ruby on Rails is two things. It's a language called Ruby and a framework called Rails. The language came out of Japan. The framework came out of 37 Signals, which they created this framework originally to build Basecamp, which is a software as a service product. And Ruby is a completely object-oriented relatively unstructured language. So unlike Java, I mean, for example, a typical web application has like a third as many lines of code in Ruby as in Java, and can be written in a half to a quarter of the time. So, you know, Adobe had been writing online stuff in Java. Ruby was like the new thing that made it so much easier and let you build stuff of equal sophistication and reliability with smaller teams. It also has a sort of an opinionated approach to how to build things, right? So it's a model view controller architecture. And instead of saying, well, you could do this way, or you could do this that way, and like when you're doing Java, you can build it any way you want, and you just have to write all these XML configuration files that explains how it all works, right? Well, with the Ruby on Rails approach, it just says, this is how it works. You put this here, you put this here. These are the defaults. All the software will just assume those defaults. If you just use those defaults, just do it like this and everything works. You know, so I think it was a brilliant way to structure it. But as I started, you know, I would have actually been happy writing little apps for local businesses. I found it really fun to do, to just go in and understand their needs and build something. But it increasingly became apparent that there was a economic mismatch, that that a typical small business might see $5,000 or $10,000 of value in a custom app, but they would see $20,000 to $50,000 in cost to build it. Mm-hmm. And the original kernel of the idea for what turned into Advanta was, can we build some kind of a general purpose platform that will be a big multi-tenant Ruby on Rails app that many different things could be built on, so they didn't need their own infrastructure, that all the common stuff was already done. You know, this time, actually our original thought, so Christopher Haupt, who had been the engineering director on these photo sharing projects, as well as other things, he left about 6 months after I did, and so we joined up to build WebVanta, really on this idea that, you know, Ruby on Rails was a big opportunity, software as a service was a big opportunity. There was a lot of buzz at the time for a couple of smart guys building some little thing that takes off, you know, and we were a little bit, probably too much of the if you build it, they will come school. And you know, so we did a bunch of things together. We did a Ruby on Rails training course. We did some live training sessions because we both like to teach. And then we built an information portal for the Ruby on Rails community, because one of the hard parts about open source communities is there's tons of information out there, but 80% of it's crap. And it's really hard to find the good 20%, right? Especially because Google values age over freshness usually for technical information, which is exactly the opposite of what you want. Mm-hmm. And so we built this sort of portal. We were doing these classes. It was totally self-funded. We were sort of resistant to the whole investment world, you know, sort of listening to all the stories from David Hanemeyer Hansen and 37 Signals about this new way to build businesses. And so we really just had this vision that we wanted a software as a service something, and we would build it in Ruby on Rails. And you know, I think there were a couple of things that made that business really, really hard. The first one was that my timing for raising money seems to be impeccable. So we were the day of my first so we did ultimately decide to go out to angels, not venture, but we decided to go to angels. The day of my first angel presentation, the headline in the Wall Street Journal was, worst financial crisis since the 30s, no end in sight. And that was as, you know, Wall Street was just totally melting down in
what, 2008?
2008. And so through a great deal of effort, we managed to raise about $1.25 million. We really needed about twice that. So we both got diverted into spending a lot of time raising money that should have been spent building product. Then we didn't have as much money as we should have had. And then, frankly, I don't think we had as good a product idea as we should have had. You know, we knew how to build the stuff. We knew how to run the company. We didn't know how to connect with customers. And, you know, it is such an obvious classic engineer running a company mistake that I kick myself and wonder how I still did it. But, you know, I think we believed that the world was moving to software as a service, that just as CRM had moved there, led by Salesforce, that web development would move there. In fact, it hasn't happened. The general WordPress as a self-hosted platform dominates the web today. Mm-hmm. And for a variety of reasons, the idea of I'm going to let someone else take care of all that infrastructure for me has been popular for simple websites and blogs, but has not ever really moved into the large, sophisticated website world, which is where mm-hmm. we wanted to play. So at Vanna, we ended up building a really nice content management system that was a fully multi-tenant hosted application. So you could just go sign up in minutes, you're building a site, had great database capabilities, way better than what WordPress had at the time. This was before WordPress had custom post types. It was really a blogging platform, whereas we were a platform for sites with rich information architectures and lots of interconnected information. But we really never found a go-to-market strategy that would get us enough customers quickly enough. And while we started off as saying we want to be a platform player and everyone else is going to build stuff on our platform, what we found was that the only way we could make money was people coming to us saying, it's great you have your own platform, but we want you to do everything, build
right,
the whole thing
build
for
it.
Us. So we sort of ended up going down the slippery slope into essentially becoming a web agency that has its own platform.
Mm-hmm. Did any other web agencies choose your platform?
Yeah, there are about a dozen around the world. And there's about half a dozen still using it today. But they tended to be agencies that would do 10 sites a year, you know? And we were viewed as a small part of the value, so we got a small part of the revenue. You know, so on that initial business strategy, we needed tens of thousands of customers, and we just weren't going to have enough capital.
So that would have meant
tens of thousands.
Mom and pop companies that wanted to have a web presence.
Well, we were typically working for small design agencies, which were typically 3, 4, 5, 10-person companies that were then working for some mom and pop, some medium-sized businesses. As time went on and we stopped working primarily through designers and started working primarily directly with companies, we focused on the larger organizations. You know, I mean, I always thought, you know, I mean, 37 Signals has this pitch of, you know, serve small businesses. There's millions of them out there. No one customer can hurt you. Yet certainly once I started talking to the investment community, they hate small business for the most part. But I kept saying, you know, no, this really is an opportunity. But I now totally understand why they hate them. They're really hard to sell to. And then they don't want to pay very much. And so, you know, we have moved up to working for educational institutions and mission-driven nonprofits where there's more value in what they're building and they have, they want more from us, you know. I mean, we just completed a project for a part of University of California called Agriculture and Natural Resources that runs things like the 4-H program and the Farm Advisors and the Master Gardener program and the California Naturalist program. And they've got a gigantic web presence that really needs to be totally revamped. So in that case, we went and, I mean, we did a half-year, you know, mid-five-figure project that actually didn't include any technology or any development at all. It was just understand what's there, understand all of the stakeholders, and make recommendations of what to do. Then we've also done work for companies like the Nature Conservancy, where we built a database-driven site that takes all the salmon conservation data and presents it in a very accessible, easy-to-understand way. So while we still have done sites for all kinds of businesses, from hardwood lumber yards to health centers to you know, cannabis dispensaries, you know, what we found was that in order to market ourselves more effectively and to move up to higher price points, we needed to become narrower. So we've last year or so, we've really been focused on this education.
That business thriving?
In mission driven market. It's doing okay. It's doing okay, you know, because I'm not able to really devote myself to it mm-hmm. at this point because of my health. We are looking for an exit for it.
What's the gang size? How many people work at?
There's about seven of us.
Okay.
And a couple of freelancers.
And do you work out, each works out of your own home? Do you have
No, we have
a
little
place?
Office in Sebastopol. I mean, we have a couple of people in Sebastopol. We've got my co-founder is up in Auburn. He's just very part-time with us. We have somebody else out in North Carolina who used to be out here but moved there. So, you know, it's a typical
miracle of modern space age communications.
Virtual
sort of
business.
Are.
That's right. And we've done a lot of work with UC Berkeley. We've done sites for the artistry department, the astronomy department, the rhetoric department, the film and media department.
You have to capitalize on your legacy of being there?
You know, a little bit. Yeah. A little bit. I think they like the fact that I went there, and I like being there. And it's just, it's been pleasant being in sort of the collegial academic environment versus the, you know, get me more clicks.
There's not as many interesting protests anymore. Okay.
So that is a Ruby on Rails application. You know, the Vanta is a Ruby on Rails app. So in some sense, we have, you know, I've stayed on that technology path that I got on when I left.
So you've gone from hardware purist to business person to consumer guy to software guy.
Yeah.
You've covered the whole computer spectrum.
In some way, yeah. And now I really think of myself primarily as a writer.
All along you've been a writer, yeah. Just about.
Yeah. So, I mean, it's been an amazing ride, and I think, you know, it's great to be here at the Computer History Museum because one of the things I've really come to appreciate is just how the sort of centuries of people standing on each other people's shoulders is what's gotten us here. It's like, mm-hmm. Nobody invented anything that could have gotten us here. It's like 1,000 incremental things, you know, right. From, you know, I mean, Pascal built a machine that could add and subtract, right? And, you know, and the Babbage stuff, right, goes back more than 100 years, right? And then you've got transistors and, I mean, first vacuum tubes and then transistors and then planar process and then VLSI and then software, you know, just it's just awe-inspiring, I think, how deep this stack is, and that today you can pull out your phone and you can browse the web and you're completely unaware of all of that, but the richness and depth of the amount of technology that's in that device is just stunning, and I find it it's hard to even think about, if you look back 50 years from now and how different the world was, and then you try to project forward 50 years from now.
Never can do it.
I feel like you just don't have a chance, right? I mean, other than Vannevar Bush, who was going to predict the web in 1945, right? Mm-hmm. I mean, he pretty much did. But for the most part, I think things are changing so fast. I mean, even when the web came out, you know, I would be a rich man today if only I had realized in 1995 that owning domain names was a valuable thing. Yeah. You know, and I look back at that and I say, why did I not get it, right? I mean, I went and bought mslater.com. Why didn't I go buy sex.com, right? And that's just 20 years ago, right? And there was no concept that domain names were a valuable thing, right? Or that you could have a phone that would let you browse the web anywhere you were, you know, or that you know, digital communication would become the primary thing that teenagers use to talk to each other. You know, it's just so much has changed and it's had so many profound impacts. In some ways, I think I'm not close enough to the semiconductor technology to know. In fact, in some ways, I never was. But, you know, I mean, I know people talk about actually hitting that Moore's law, mm-hmm. You know, getting to the point where we're just not going to keep doubling every year. I'm not sure that matters that much, right? I mean, I think you could freeze hardware technology for the next 50 years and software right. wouldn't catch up with the opportunities that are there. So I think it's going to be just incredibly exciting to see what happens, not for me, but for everybody else who's able to be there for that next 50 years. You know, clearly we're going to have just ample access to any kind of information you want, right? Everything, you're going to be able to talk to all your machines. They're going to, you know, I mean, a lot of the stuff, if you go back to like Apple's early knowledge navigator videos, right? Almost all that is now ordinary, right? It's like my iPhone does almost all that, you know? And, you know, and one of the things that back, so early 90s, right? Everyone was saying, people are going to keep buying faster and faster processors because we're going to have these, you know, we've done 2D, now we're going to go to 3D, right? Well, nobody actually came up with a 3D user interface that anybody cared about. Mm-hmm. And so it seems that, like, speech recognition has become that next thing with Siri and all that sort of things.
But that took hardware. That took a lot of hardware capability to be able to pull off.
Yeah, it's that mix of the hardware and the.
I mean, both hardware and software. I think the software.
But I feel like my imagination is just not up to the task of trying to look more than about 10 years out, because things just change so radically. And I think, it's such an enigma, because in one sense, you could say almost all the change is incremental. Right? If you look at each little thing, it's incremental. Yet you look at now versus 20 years from now, and it feels just wildly and conceptually different. Right. So there's some way in which all these incremental changes just, you know, like phones got to a point where all of a sudden they were this completely different thing. Which, by the way, I think had much less to do with the technology and more to do with the fact that Apple disintermediated the carriers from being able to control the phones.
So if you were that young person again, that 21-year-old or whatever, you know, or going to the university, what would you pursue in order to prepare yourself for this unknown future, unpredictable future?
Well, I'll tell you, my perspective has shifted a lot by getting cancer and by being older and by thinking about the world and by being curious about things. I'd probably study genetics if I went to school today. This is what I find really fascinating today, is trying to understand what people are and how they work. You know, that we have this whole genome and we've got all this data, you know, and there are a few things we understand. And it's also, it's even more incredible than the electronics. You know, I mean, you look at what actually goes on in our body and the way the chromosomes work and all that, you know, and it would seem wildly outlandish and unlikely if it weren't for the fact that you can actually prove that it's all actually happening. But the amount that's actually understood, you know, people talk about the Human Genome Project and, you know, now we know the human genome. Well, you know, they understand less than 1.5% of what any of it does, right? They've got a list of genes, but the
you can list this program, but you have no idea what the program does, right?
Right. So I think that the, the problem I would have with going to school with that is it works against my desire to build things. So maybe I still would go to engineering school.
Well, that's engineering, but it's not.
It is engineering, right? Yeah. But you know, but what I find most fascinating today is that I feel like we are at the cusp with the ability to quickly sequence genomes, right? So like a team of three people would work for 5 years on something that can now be done in an hour. So that ability, you know, I think is going to create a lot of data, and there's just going to be a whole lot learned about life and people and disease. And, you know, if I were to start over, frankly, I would want to pursue something where I felt like it made a more of a humanist difference. You know, I'm not sure that, I think I've made a difference in that I've brought communities together and, you know, I've built some cool stuff, but if I could start it all over, I'd like to make a contribution to health.
Well, I'm not sure exactly about health, but I would disagree that you haven't made a contribution. Partly the work you did helped to make everybody's iPhone better. And we all love that.
Yeah.
And that's life. That's not, it's not prolonged life, you have in mind, but it is life.
Yeah. Well, if that's true, I'm honored. And, you know, I do think we've made a contribution. And I wouldn't have kept doing it if I didn't feel like we have. And really, the thing that kept me going with Microprocessor Report was all the feedback I got from people, you know, saying how valuable they've found it, you know. And what keeps me going in my current company is the feedback from customers that tell us how valuable we find it. You know, it all ultimately comes down to people and interactions with people. You know, and in some sense, you know, even the failings of Microprocessor Report, like the relationship with Intel, right, ultimately came down to people. It's, the issues were not the ability to understand something or the technical stuff or you know.
Encouraging Nick to insult Intel.
Yeah.
That would
lack of assignment, lack of alignment of motivation.
Well, I think this has been a very interesting couple of hours we've spent. And we want to thank you very much for your time here. And we offer you the opportunity to go see some of the exhibits now.
Great. Well, thank you very much for the opportunity. I'm very pleased to have had the chance to make the recording.
Thank you, Michael.